Hello, everyone. I am here with 2020 congressional candidate Anthony Clark running against Danny K. Davis in Illinois' 7th congressional district, and he's here to talk about his campaign. Anthony, thank you so much for coming on the program.
No. Hello, everyone. How you doing? Hello. Thank you for having me. I truly appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, I've been following your campaign now because this is the second time that you're running, and I wanted to have you on the first time, didn't get you on, but now I'm writing that wrong. And we're letting everyone know that you are a phenomenal candidate. You're one of the original Justice Democrats, members of brand new Congress. And I always ask this to candidates because there's a number of people running for Congress for a second time. You're one of several. So Cori Bush is another one who's running for Congress, had her on the show last time. So what made you want to run for Congress? Because you're incredibly busy. You run a nonprofit. You have a lot going on. You're a teacher. So you're dedicating so much of your time and energy. Just running for Congress once, like I could imagine, would be exhausting. What made you want to do it a second time? Why put yourself through this when you already are doing so much for your community?
Yeah, definitely. Wonderful question. Thanks for asking it. To understand why I ran the first time and why I'm running again, you know, it ties directly into my parents, Ron and Blanche Clark. Shout out to them. Love them to death. My best friends to this day. Just the sacrifices they made throughout their lives to an effort to provide me with greater opportunity. Right. Access to opportunity. That's a key theme throughout our campaign and has been throughout my life. And then when you combine that with the fact that, you know, I obsess over Muhammad Ali, like I'm a huge Muhammad Ali fan, watched his fights still to this day, followed his fights, you know, followed his career inside and outside of the ring. And he was someone like my father, who I believe to be a true hero, to have true courage and to not always go with status quo. And one of his best quotes, that I continue to take with me, and I actually have it tatted on my forearm here. I don't think if you can see it or not, but it says, "The rent I pay," because the Ali quote is, "Service to others is the rent you pay for room here on this earth." So throughout my life, you know, I served in the military. That was not necessarily by choice. You know, I did find myself in some trouble as a youth, like many of us do, and trying to get myself out of that, you know, the military happened to be an option. So serving in the military and seeing firsthand the military industrial complex, seeing firsthand how one person's patriot can be another person's terrorist, getting that exposure, coming home, becoming a high school teacher, seeing how our educational system is essentially broken, how so many families and students are failing within a public school system that's inequitable because of the public funding model that exists, how property taxes essentially fund our schools, founding a nonprofit, you know, prior to this new administration in 2016, focused on equity work, being the co-founder of a small business, employing at-risk youth, everything I've been doing, inside and outside of employment, you know, in the community has been an effort to pay rent, you know, because even as a black man in America, you know, I recognize the privilege I've had throughout my life, particularly having such a strong parental base, so that's what led me essentially to accept the nomination in the first place. Because when the community nominated me, you know, I was Village of the Year in 2017, whatever the hell that means. You know, I'm really not big on personal accolades. You know, I thank the community for that because we truly work together. But when I was nominated, I was hesitant at first, you know, because I never saw myself as a politician. I was jaded, you know, by our current representation, how our current policies were going and so on and so forth. But when I sat down, I started thinking to myself, as a teacher, as a nonprofit director, you know, as a small business co-owner, you know, as a community activist and organizer, I was essentially treating symptoms. I never had the ability to truly target the root cause. So, for example, running a nonprofit, we would constantly do food drives, clothing drives, you know, for the homeless populations that exist. But we never got to the root cause of why homelessness exists and the fact that housing should be a human right, correct? So Absolutely. We weren't treating the root cause. Housing should be a human right. But at my level, I was essentially treating a symptom. The same people we were helping on Monday, they would still need help on Friday. So how could we change things on a systemic level? So when I was nominated, I finally figured out that running for office, accepting that nomination, becoming one of the OGs, which we are now, some of the originals, was the ability to truly get within Congress and change policy. We have to change policy. We have to change legislation. But legislation isn't even enough. We have to change the hearts and the minds of the American people if we truly want to address what I believe is a society built upon the genocide of natives and the enslavement of Africans and African descendants to perpetuate capitalism and to promote and maintain white supremacy. If we're going to truly change that, We have to address root causes. And that's why I accepted the nomination. And anybody knows, hopefully, that anybody out there, if you run once, please run again. Because the way the machine and the establishment, the way some of the ways they maintain power is by building name recognition and counting on corporate dollars. You know, they're going to have more money than a grassroots candidate. And if they've been in office for 10 to 20 years, because, of course, they like to maintain power, they have larger name recognition. You know, so you have to run to lay a foundation. You know, Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Congresswoman Ilhan Omar, I mean, they're superstars. You know, I look up to them. They're idols. You know, I know AOC personally. I thank her for everything she's done in inspiring me and others. But not every race is going to be like that. You can be awesome yourself, but it may take more than once. It may take more than two times. But the fight is that important. So for me, running once was never going to be an option. You run once. Of course, we were in it to win. We came up short, but we learned so much from that race. And now we're back building at a momentum. We're better prepared, and we're going to take it this time.
And that's kind of what I'm hearing, and it's really inspiring. Like, Amy Valela is another individual who ran for Congress, and she didn't win. She came up short, but she kind of said the same thing. Like, you know, I learned so much. Now I know what I need to do to win. I have the tools needed. And you brought up your representative. So his name is Danny K. Davis. He's been in that seat since 1997. And when you compare someone like him who's entrenched within the political establishment to someone like you, I mean, I really feel like it's no contest. It really is a matter of people knowing who you are, and you're already so involved with your community. So you're doing things to help people on a daily basis. Like, you're not suspending the work that you're doing to help out your peers just because you're running for Congress. Like, before we came on, for viewers, Anthony was telling me about a program that he's doing to get people to donate fans to people in the heat and whatnot. Do you want to talk a little bit about that and some of the things that you're doing, like, to help feed members who are less fortunate in your community? Because I think that it can't be, you know, it can't be overstated how important this is, because you're doing it, one, because you genuinely care, but I think that this is a true representative. Like, you're already representing people in the 7th District. So talk a little bit about your nonprofit work and what you're doing, because I find it just absolutely fascinating.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. First and foremost, I want to give a shout out to Amy. It's her birthday today, so happy birthday,
Happy birthday, Amy.
That is the homegirl for life. You know, thank you for everything that you do. Love you and your family, and thank you for believing in us. So in 2016, you know, prior to ever being a candidate, prior to ever being nominated, again, being in the community and just seeing so many of my young students and families struggling within a system that by design was not created to empower them, I felt like I had to do more. You know, it wasn't enough to, you know, get inside the classroom. It wasn't enough to just organize and simply show up. I wanted to go further and actually create an organization that, again, try to, because we haven't yet, but try to attack more of the root causes that exist. So Suburban Unity Alliance, suburbanunity.org, is my nonprofit organization. We're 501c3. You know, we're 100% volunteer based. I make no money from this nonprofit, because let's be honest, some nonprofits are part of the issue as well. I think we saw on the news today a particular nonprofit that let go of some employees that have disabilities because, again, it was hurting their bottom line. So, again, we are 100% grassroots, 100% volunteer based. And it's just about getting out and building bridges between communities, because we truly believe the health of one community directly impacts the health of other communities, like the health of an individual directly impacts the health of other individuals. So we've done a lot of work on building empathy, building bridges between communities that you can literally cross the street and everything changes, from the access to opportunity to the level of gun violence to food deserts that exist. So based upon that work, based upon building extremely strong coalitions with other organizations like Vesta Proviso Township, like Opark Call to Action, like PASO, West Suburban Action Project, we've been involved and had our hands in so many different things, some things that I could throw out there. We had two young women who were attending my high school. They were victims, but I like to call them survivors and warriors of sex trafficking. And they were under the Salvation Army, and they were living at a home called Ann's House. Well, the Salvation Army cut funding. So these young women, these two young women, were essentially going to be left on the street. They had nowhere to go. They were going to have to leave the school that they were currently in at the time. So we put it out to the community. We organized. And in one day, we raised over $13,000. We found these two young women a new placement, and they were able to, you know, continue their educational careers and finish high school. You know, they're able to graduate. Now, was it perfect? Again, did we treat the root cause? No. but at least we were getting out, trying to get behind and empower these wonderful students, these wonderful young ladies. Other things we've done, you know, there was a rape that had occurred in the school district. You know, young women came to us. We got behind them, empowered them. We created a petition, actually got out into the community and literally changed the sexual assault policy, collaborating with other organizations within the community. We've changed the racial equity policy within the community as well, and actually had a racial equity coordinator position created through collaboration. We've helped to support PASO in passing welcoming village ordinances within the local community. So, I mean, we could go on and on, you know, but yeah. It's powerful because it taps in and it builds empathy, because I feel like throughout history, ignorance has also led to so many individuals being complicit in the dehumanization and oppression of others. You know, similar to what we're seeing with our immigrant populations currently. You dehumanize, so then people on the outside that it's not directly impacting, they don't care. You know, this is not impacting me. You know, like, oh, the current president said these are rapists, these are drug dealers. Who cares? But we should all care, because again, it should impact us as human beings. So we've engaged in that work. You know, one of the biggest things, and I'll leave it here because we could go on and on. There was a local church that was being harassed by white supremacist organizations. They reached out to our organization. We were able to fundraise. We purchased this local church, a state-of-the-art security system to surround the church. And we took it further than that. We actually went to the church, you know, got trained on filling out DACA renewal applications. So we would go there almost every week and sit with dreamers and learn more about their lives, you know, learn more about their journeys and their truths, and help them fill out these forms to fight, you know, to fight to remain in this country that they've given so much to. And it was interesting that so many people didn't even realize that many of our undocumented population, they actually pay taxes. You know, they're working, they're paying taxes, they're giving to a community that does not give back to them. You know, so things like that help to break down those ignorances, hopefully, and help to break down those barriers. So that's what we've engaged in at SUA. You know, we're fighters, we rock the boat. You know, I've been in trouble often for rocking the boat, you know, through my organization, suspended several times. My life has been threatened. I've been attacked. But the community has always stepped up in support and protest and sit-ins, you know, and really have our backs, because they believe in, again, it's bigger than just legislation. Like, we're actually fighting, you know, an ideological war. And, you know, that's what we engage in.
And this is why, like, you're already a representative, or the representative. It's just a matter of now, you know, you can get elected and gain the power to really treat these root causes, which you talked about. And it's remarkable. Like, few people do this because, you know, it requires a lot of time. It requires a lot of dedication. And it can be demoralizing, you know, seeing all of these things that are going on, all these issues in your community. But it's a dedication that I see with congressional candidates that you don't see. Like, when you juxtapose the work that you're doing with any member of Congress, you just see that detachment. Like, they're not in their communities. They don't even hold town halls often, you know? So
no.
The difference is night and day between candidates like you, progressive grassroots funded candidates, and basically anyone from the establishment. So what I usually do on the show is whenever I get a candidate on, we'll do like these rapid fire questions while I ask you something and, you know, see if you check all the boxes, the progressive boxes, just so people know how progressive you are. But I realized that that's pointless because these candidates running, everyone including you, you check all the boxes and you are phenomenal. And all these ideas that you're proposing are absolutely, they'd be life-changing, basically. So let me just go through a couple of them. Medicare for all, reparations for American descendants of slavery, canceling student loan debt. Like, these are things that you lay out in your ad. And when I looked at your website, one thing that really stood out to me, which is kind of, I wouldn't say new, but it's talked about less often, is you mention animal rights and anti-cruelty legislation. So, I mean, these are things that we're not hearing being discussed in Congress. So with that being said, along those lines of policy, let's say you're elected to Congress and there's all these issues, like you have a 100-point plan as to what you want to do. I think you have a more robust policy platform than most people running for president.
So we do.
What do you do when you're elected? Like, how do you focus? Like, what would be your main priorities? Because I don't know where I would begin just personally if I were elected. I don't know where I would start. So what do you think you would do as an elected member of Congress within the first year? What would you fight for, you know, initially?
So to answer that question, first and foremost, I think, you know, many of us understand that the issues are interconnected, so they require interconnected solutions. And for me, it starts at a micro and a macro level when I become the next representative of Illinois' 7th Congressional District, because within our district, it's extremely gerrymandered. I mean, we have communities within our district where the median household income is around $110,000. And then you could go literally across the street and the median household income drops down to $34,000. I mean, that's vast disparity that exists. And often these communities have operated with metaphorical and physical walls between them, where they're not collaborating, they're not working together to truly push for improvements. So at a micro level, when I become the next representative, I'm going to take the work we've already been doing, you know, as a nonprofit leader, as a teacher, you know, as a community activist and organizer, to knock down these metaphorical and physical walls and to get our communities to work stronger together, you know, to come together. Because again, in the Austin community, we have food deserts within the 7th Congressional District. So where do individuals have to shop? You know, either at a corner store eating processed foods, or they have to go into a community like Oak Park, bring their money, so their money doesn't even remain in their community, to invest in other communities because they need to eat proper food and proper produce. So let's work together. Let's talk about the importance of building co-ops, cooperatives, empowering people within our communities on the ground. So using that influence to further educate, because honestly, the Democratic Party benefits just like the Republican Party, I think, from, you know, lack of voter education, low voter turnout, you know, the jadedness of many voters like I have been before in my lifetime. So we have to address those issues on a micro level, you know, truly build coalitions on the ground, truly use our influence to strengthen all communities and have communities work together and empower each other. And at a macro level, of course, we have, I mean, four wonderful congresspersons right now with strong representation, you know, truly speaking truth to power, truly rocking the boat. So I think once I win this seat and once I get into office, one of my roles is to get behind them, back them, and help to empower them, use whatever privilege I have to further strengthen their messages. Because again, we see how the establishment is responding. We see how the Republican Party is responding. When you rock the boat, when you don't accept status quo like our incumbent in the 7th has been doing for decades, you are identified as a problem. And again, we need support. You know, we really do. So I want to support them in all of their efforts and all of their work. And I think for everything that we're fighting for, the climate is the most important issue, honestly, because we don't have an earth to live on right now. We have, what, 11 years left to address this existential crisis. So the Green New Deal has to be at the top of the list. We have to truly fight for and support the Green New Deal. We're building support on the ground. You know, shout out to Sunrise Movement, Sunrise Movement Chicago. We've been doing a lot of collaborative work with them. So many wonderful young leaders out there, again, not waiting, not being patient, not patiently knocking on the door. They're kicking the door down because they know how important these issues are. And again, you know, climate change is extremely important. The Green New Deal, I think, is first and foremost the main issue that I would like to fight for, get behind and help support. And then after that, of course, you named many of them. You know, we have to address the military-industrial complex because education is a huge issue within our community. I think we could take the billions of dollars that we're spending on our military and our warped sense of what patriotism is and redirect that to community infrastructure, to our educational systems that are inequitably funded by property taxes. So we have to address those issues. The war on drugs has to end. No question. You know, we were the only campaign in 2018 to push for the legalization of cannabis with a focus on racial justice. You know, we weren't waiting on the wave. We weren't waiting on the community to step up. We were being bold and taking that stand. Of course, single payer health care is extremely important. All these things lead to, you know, greater job opportunity, greater infrastructure investment, and overall empowerment for the people that exist. And like you mentioned, we're fighting for bold issues as well, like reparations. You know, if you understand that, again, throughout history, the government has played a direct role in oppressing individuals locally and at a federal level, determining that Black and brown communities primarily do not build generational social and economic wealth, you will understand the importance of reparations. It cannot just be one check. Mm-hmm. It cannot just be one check, because many of our white families and our white allies, they built their wealth through what? Home ownership, passing that value down, that property down through generations. You're able to build up generational wealth through redlining, through Jim Crow, through slavery. Many individuals have not been able to do that. So we have to address those issues. So we could go on and on. But the most important thing, again, at the end of the day, is to understand that we have to build stronger coalitions, and we have to recognize that, yes, we have to fight for and push bold legislation like the decrim of sex work. We didn't mention that before. 100% the decriminalization of sex work. That's extremely important. But also, we have to fight this ideological war, and we cannot be afraid to face down white supremacy, stare it in the eyes, and let it know we're not stopping.
And call it what it is. Like, I think a lot of people are conditioned by Republicans to, like, not call Tucker Carlson, for example, a white supremacist, or not call racism racism, but you see people who in Congress are not backing down now. Like, the way that progressives and democratic socialists have moved this conversation, it really is remarkable. Like, I still think that the Overton window is shifted too far to the right, but just to see how far we've moved dialogue, it's amazing. And this is kind of, and you can correct me if I'm wrong here, the way that I feel and what I'm learning as we see more and more congressional races is that it's a matter of getting your name out. Like, I truly believe that if enough people know you and they don't just go off of name recognition of your opponent, you win. Like, 10 times out of 10, you'd win. So talk a little bit about your opponent, because you're running against Danny K. Davis. What is it about him that you think needs to be challenged? Why is he inadequate in representing your community?
Yeah, I mean, for me, you know, great question. I think it's impossible to call yourself a progressive if the district that you represent is not progressing, or if you're not actively fighting for progress. I think too often, you know, within our political scope and realm, yes, we have like Republican candidates that a Democrat may challenge that gets a lot of attention, right? Because, of course, we want to flip a district, we want to flip an area. Or we have an unpopular Democratic representative that maybe oftentimes votes Republican, or, you know, just, you know, is against, you know, progressive issues such as LGBTQI plus rights, women's rights, so on and so forth. So it's easy to get the community up. You know, it's easy to get the community to pay attention and support, you know, a uprising grassroots candidate. But somebody like Danny K. Davis, who's been in office for decades and decades, to me, you know, I thank him for his service. I'm not a negative individual, but he's just essentially maintained status quo. Individuals like him survive on voting the right way. But you have to also fight. You have to also be bold. Don't wait till someone else comes forward and pushes the legalization of cannabis, which he was against in 2018. But then now you feel the pressure and now you see the wave. So now, oh, OK, you know, I'll sponsor it. I'll co-sponsor it. I'll jump on the wave. We have to create the wave. And he hasn't created any progressive waves in this district for decades and decades. I mean, our unemployment rate used to be at 4 times the national average. It's still at 2.5% the national average. Individuals in our community are moving out by droves. Illinois is either 1, 2, or 3 across the nation, and individuals moving out of the state. And our district leads Illinois in regards to individuals moving out of the city. You know, communities like the Austin community, they're dealing with gun violence on a daily and weekly basis. I have lost 11 students to gun violence in my 10 years of teaching. I'm wearing one on my wrist right now. Elijah Sims was murdered, shot in the head a day before his 17th birthday. And we go out into the community constantly fighting for justice for him, fighting to address the root cause issues that led to gun violence that took his life and others' lives. It's a serious issue that exists. We have food deserts. I mean, there's a video online. I challenge people to look it up. You could type in Danny Davis and Arnie Duncan. I don't know if you're familiar with Arnie Duncan, Mr. Privatization. I'm 100% against privatization of our prison industries, of our educational systems, of course, of our healthcare. Because again, any privatization puts profit before the people. We have multiple school closures that exist in our district, multiple mental health facility closures that exist, lack of infrastructure investment in our communities. We could go on and on. I mean, how we're impacted by our environment, the lead in our water, the lead in our paint, the high levels of asthma that exist, the heroin highway that exists. I mean, there's so many different connections. So at the end of the day, I thank him for his service, but he's been someone that's been focused on individual power, maintaining status quo, not rocking the boat. Meanwhile, we're coming along and being extremely bold, building bold coalitions and pushing for progressive issues and for change. And we're not waiting. We're setting the trends. We're not waiting for the trend to set itself and then jumping on. We're setting it and moving forward and trying to help educate the community on why it's important to be progressive and bold, why it's important to empower people and recognize that the government has played a role. The government is part of the problem, which includes the Democratic Party. So, I mean, it's no question to me it's time for change. And if you look at our website, as you stated, I think we have, what, 24 policy positions, fully articulated policy positions. I'm leaving no room for any loopholes, no room for pandering, no room for backing off. You know exactly where we stand and exactly what we're fighting for, because it's that important.
Thank you for saying that, because it's really important, especially in these types of races. Like, you're not running against someone who is a Democratic superstar. Like, you're not challenging someone with a lot of name recognition or has particularly been a target to progressives and social Democrats. So it is important for you to really lay out, I think, these key distinctions. Like, you can't just ride the wave of change. You have to be a leader. And if anybody in your community has been a leader, it's been you. So I don't think anyone who's watching this, who's a regular viewer of the Humanist Report, is not going to be convinced. So now we go to, what do we do to guarantee your victory? Because I think this time You're going to win. So how do we guarantee that win? What can we do to help you? Can we phone bank if we don't live in Illinois?
Right. Oh,
can
yes.
we donate? Where can we go?
Definitely.
Give us what we can
Definitely.
do.
Yeah, I mean, and I'll tell a quick story. When we ran in 2018, the incumbent and his team spent inordinate amount of hours stealing our yard signs, you know, harassing us. He told me to my face the reason he was going to win was because he had 30 years of name recognition. And literally his slogan on his literature was "the name you know." Like, that was his slogan,
Wow.
the name you know. So we have to build name recognition. And our campaign, our team is out there on a daily basis canvassing, door knocking, phone banking, building relationships with community members. And yet I'm still teaching full time. Yet I'm still running my nonprofit full time because that work is extremely important. So one thing you definitely can do is spread the message. You know, if you listen to this interview today, if you like what you hear, if you like what you see, if you visit our website at voteanthonyclark.com and you truly believe in the movement that we're a part of, let your friends know. Let your families know. Call everybody you know in Chi-Town, in Chicago, in Oak Park, in the entire 7th Congressional District, and let them know, hey, there's an option out there. There's somebody out there truly fighting for change, and you can believe in them, and they're going to support you as an individual and as a collective. We also need donations. Yes, donations are extremely important. Again, we're not going against an incumbent that's, you know, extremely popular, extremely controversial. They just exist. They're just there, allowing their communities to suffer while they maintain individual power. So individual small donations, because we're 100% grassroots. We took the pledge. We're taking zero corporate money. We're taking zero medical or pharmaceutical money. By the way, the incumbent is. He says he's, again, jumping the wave of Medicare for all, but yet you're taking money from pharmaceutical companies, thousands of dollars. You say you're for immigrant rights, but yet you're taking thousands of dollars from Amazon, who is known to work with the Department of Homeland Security and ICE. So these are huge issues. And because often we don't pay attention, we allow individuals to co-opt and cloak themselves in progressivism. So again, spread the message, help build name recognition. You can phone bank if you don't live locally. We have a wonderful online system. Reach out to us through voteanthonyclark.com, and you can sign up to volunteer. Donate. And I'll be honest with you. My team gets on me all the time because I'm a horrible fundraiser. I'll be straight up with you. I know how many of us are struggling out there. I know how hard it is. I have bill collectors calling me on a weekly basis. So I know, but I guarantee you, if you have a dollar to spare, $5 to spare, $10 to spare, $20 to spare, know that it's going to a righteous cause. And I'm not taking your donation in vain, because I'm giving everything we have. I'm giving everything I have and everything we have as a team to truly fight. So go to voteanthonyclark.com, sign up to volunteer, help share the link, spread the message, donate if you can, because that's truly going to help us continue to take the fight to the Democratic establishment and to the Republican Party as well, and to the overall institution and system that exists that oppresses individuals like ourselves. So that's extremely important.
And thank you for running as well. And let me just add a little bit to your pitch as well. And I always say this so it sounds redundant, but this is a national movement. Like, this isn't just about the 7th Congressional District. Of course,
right.
Anthony is running to represent that. But what if you donate to Anthony and you don't live in the 7th District, that still essentially is an investment. Because, I mean, look at Ilhan Omar. She's not from my state, but she just sponsored legislation that would cancel my student loan debt. So by supporting these candidates monetarily and just through sharing the message, this is something that will benefit you personally, and this is an investment. And, you know, we're laying the groundwork for revolutionary change in this country, and it starts by just giving up a buck or two, if that's all you can spare, because a little bit goes a long way. And if a lot of people
Definitely.
Do a little bit, it has a huge difference. So go to voteanthonyclark.com. Anthony, thank you so much for coming on the program. Again, I apologize for not bringing you on in 2018. I missed you. I missed so many candidates, but I'm writing that wrong this time. Thank you so
Definitely.
Much. Is there anything else you want to say before we leave?
No, you know, I just want to, you know, give a shout out and truly thank each and everybody that's in this fight. You know, another quote that I love, and I'm going to end it with this, is Martin Luther King. You know, his quote is, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, keep moving forward. So many of us continue to move forward, push for progress. But also remember, self-care is extremely important, because this fight is daunting. It takes a lot out of us. It's a marathon, not a sprint. But I sincerely thank and appreciate each and every one of you that play a role in moving us forward. And again, challenge yourselves, look yourselves in the mirror after this interview, and also ask yourself, what are you willing to risk and sacrifice for real change? Because we have to do more than Facebook posts. We have to do more than just show up at a march on a Saturday, then go back to work within the same system Monday through Friday that led to the oppression we were marching against. It's really going to take us sacrificing and putting ourselves on the line for systemic change. But again, love you all. VoteAnthonyClark.com. All power to the people.